We should start. We've got a kind of an interesting presentation today. And before we get started, anybody have any announcements they want? Oh, what about the Grammys? Anybody see the Grammys last night? Lady Gaga, wow. The whole thing was a lot of great performances. Strange in many ways. Arcade Fire, what did that do for you? Arcade Fire, huh? Anybody have any announcements about gigs coming up or anything like that? Hillary, is that you? Oh, Hillary has a microphone, and Michael has a microphone. So we're doing this new thing, it's called the roving microphone. So if you have something to say, the mic will come to you. Anybody have anything to say? Oh, John Paul does.
Hello? If you don't have Valentine's Day plans or want to get rid of them, the songwriters are hosting a hot chocolate music series tonight in Satchmo's from 8 to 10. We'll be playing some of our most angsty songs we have on file. Free hot chocolate of a mystery variety. The only way to find out is to be there. So, Satchmo's 8. Thank you very much.
Nice. Anybody else? Oh, here we go. Hold it with Simon. 1 second. Okay, here we go. You're on, Bubba.
Yo, what's up, y'all?
That's it.
So this Saturday at the Mudlark Theater in the Bywater, which is right by where Crew de Vue is going to be, we're going to do the Newgrass benefit show. It's called Marley Fest. And Sun Hotel, Newgrass, Native America, Cattywampus, and Habitat are all going to play. It's going to be from like 4:20 until we stop the hate, so however long that takes. And in case y'all don't know, it's a benefit for Newgrass, who got all of their equipment stolen last weekend. So all the money goes to them. It's $5. There's kegs, and there's a compilation that we made to stopthehate.bandcamp.com, and it's $5. That goes to Newgrass, too. So spread the word and help out if you can. Thanks, y'all.
Thank you very much. Simon?
Hey, I need to know if anybody knows CSS or HTML, because I'm in Bob Rainey's class and I don't know anything about it at all. If anybody would help me out tonight after, hey, any CSS, that guy, he helped me before. And both, Stan Richardson, both of y'all helped me before. Could y'all please help me with my CSS homework and my HTML homework? Honestly, I don't understand any of it at all. It is terrible. And that's really all I have to say. I'm putting out a music video tonight, if anybody cares. YouTube.com/TopBeanTV, TopBillionTV. But CSS homework is more important, really. And that's
there's
it.
There's your guy. There's another guy there that'll help. These guys will help. Who else got something to say?
I'm gonna say something until whoever gets the mic. Hello, lyrics. Kind of the same agenda as him, just less important. If there's anyone who does press kits, like if you're trying to do press kits or, you know, the promo for the artist, please get at me, because I need my press kit updated and things of that nature. And my website is thekidlyrics.com, so check that out. But I really need a press kit done. So if anyone does that, come holler at me and we could, yeah. Thanks.
All right. Anybody else? No other music around, huh? Okay. Before I introduce our guest, you know, if you wouldn't mind, give our guest your undivided attention, so close your laptops, please. This is not the place for that. So Robert Bell teaches English in the English department, and some of you may have had his classes, and he does a great first-year experience seminar that's very popular, and tonight he's going to give you the distilled version of that, and then there's going to be some action to result from it, so be careful of that. So please welcome Robert Bell.
First off, I want to thank y'all for inviting me today. I think the music industry program here at Loyola is really one of the hallmarks of Loyola, and I think the education you're getting, the experience you're getting here is second to none. And so I really want to thank John Schneider for inviting me, and thanking all of y'all for having me today. Y'all really do a great job, and y'all are a great group of students, so keep the fight alive. We are going to, I'm going to kind of talk a little bit about protest and pop music. And so I figured the logical starting place for such a discussion is the question of what separates us from animals, which is, I assume, pretty obvious to all of you. Many people think that it's that we have opposable thumbs, but other animals have opposable thumbs, like monkeys, chimpanzees. In fact, when I was a little kid, the barber shop I used to go to, they would always talk about a man who came in with a little monkey. And any time a woman would come in the barber shop, the monkey would do really unusual things with his thumbs. So opposable thumbs, and you know, animals do that too, so it's not just people with opposable thumbs. Sometimes people might think that it's, well, we have highly organized hierarchical societies. Well, insects have the same thing, so it's not that separates us. Maybe it's the fact that we go to war, we torture, we do terrible things. Well, you know, we're not alone in that either. So it's getting harder to figure out what separates us from the animals then at that point. Maybe it's the fact that we play games, that we're so evolved. Well, cats can play games with iPads. That's designed just for cats, by the way. If you own an iPad and you have a cat, that sure be hours of fun.
That only human beings can feel emotions like sorrow and grief. This footage will change your mind. An elephant family in Kenya's Amboseli National Park comes upon the bones of their own matriarch. As they tend to do whenever they encounter any elephant bones, the elephants first gather around the bones in a defensive circle. Then they turn the bones over, picking them up, feeling every crevice. After this, they touch the bones with their hind feet. Scientists who have studied elephant behavior are certain that elephants experience deep emotions and have some understanding about death. Everything about the way these elephants are grieving here proves that point.
So, obviously, other animals understand their own mortality. So we're starting to have trouble with what separates us from animals, if anything. One of the last things that I can think of is that we create art. Now let's see if that's necessarily the case.
In 1962, Desmond Morris published his book, The Biology of Art, which details his experiments teaching chimpanzees to paint. The chimps enjoyed painting immensely and eagerly created works of energetic colors and strokes. One phase of Morris's experiment involved rewarding the chimps for producing their paintings. Whenever a chimpanzee painted, he received a peanut. Surprisingly, very soon the quality of paintings began to degenerate until the chimps produced the bare minimum that would satisfy the experimenter. Any joy found in the act of painting was lost as the chimps uncaringly slapped paint on their canvases and ran to collect their peanuts.
Well, maybe that's more comment about what happens when you commercialize art than whether or not animals create art, so I'm not sure. But what I think we're on the right path here, because I think one of the things that separates us from the animals, and maybe not all of them, but some of them at least, is that we can create art that reflects and helps mitigate the human condition. And we can create art that reflects upon art. So we're kind of moving up in terms of the cognitive abilities. So if we, for instance, whoops, I don't know what the hell just happened. So for instance, we have a Grecian urn, right? Here's a beautiful symmetrical object that has form as well as function. And of course, gazing upon something like this where it has a slave in the front, obviously those in higher social order riding, allows someone like, well, I don't want to say who, anybody know? Anybody want to extra credit? Beauty is truth, truth beauty, that is all ye on earth, all ye know on earth, and all ye need to know. Come on, extra credit? No. Keats, Ode on a Grecian Urn. Okay, great. Excellent. And we can also have someone like Ovid, who writes in the Metamorphoses, and even when he had been received into the house of shadows, he gazed into the Stygian waters, which of course then inspire someone to create a plastic art, Caravaggio's Narcissus. And what's so great about this painting, really, if you look at it, is the reflection, right? That reflection is not the same. So see how we're kind of getting more complicated with the way we use art. Dickens, as we move forward, can write The Tale of Two Cities, A Tale of Two Cities, London and Paris during the French Revolution. So here he is with his realism, talking about what's happening during these times of social upheaval. Moving into America in 1906, you've got Upton Sinclair's The Jungle, social realism, which is starting to use art to really expose what's happening under the current and prevailing economic system that's occurring in the turn of the century here, in particular the meatpacking industry in Chicago. Early in the century, we experienced in the United States the Great Depression, the crash of 1929, and then you can see it goes into the mid-30s. At this same time, in the United States, what's happening socially is the great labor movement. Although we don't, you know, the labor movements have been primarily at this point are a thing way of the past. At that time, it was very exciting because there was a lot of mass social movements, gatherings of people trying to work towards changing the economic base of society. These kind of mass movements are petering out, at least in the Western world, but of course if you look at what's happened in Tunisia, Egypt, Yemen, Jordan, Lebanon, there's a lot going on right now in other parts of the world. The interesting thing about Egypt is that it primarily is not an Islamic revolution, it's really a class-oriented revolution, which is very interesting. So we have the rise of the labor movements. The IWW formed in Chicago, the industrial workers of the world, the Wobblies. Joe Hill was the great singer for the Wobblies, wrote songs about the union and the kind of evils of big business at the time. And what was interesting, when you joined the IWW, not only did you get a union card, but you got a little pocketbook of songs. Because songs were very important at the time, right? This is really before mass media, as we know it, exists. And so one of the primary ways that we were able to get messages across in a way that was also captured people's attention was through song. And so let me show you here the Almanac Singers. Now they started in the 40s, but Woody Guthrie and Pete Seeger were both members of the Almanac Singers, and they really kind of focused on union-type songs. These are magnetic songs. These are songs, the goal is to get people to join the union. We have these terrible working conditions. People are being exploited. We want to change what's happening. How do we change what's happening? You join the union. So let's listen to the Almanac Singers. Roll the union on. And we will see how good our internet connection is at this point. Everybody, focus on the internet. And keep focusing on the internet.
Roll right over him. We're gonna roll the union on. We're gonna. get in the way. We're gonna roll right over them. We're gonna roll right over them. We're gonna roll right over them. If the goons get in the way, we're gonna roll right over them. We're gonna roll the Union on.
The goal of this song is to promote solidarity within the union and get people to join the union. Notice how the song is real sing-along-y. It's really designed to get people involved, because hopefully if you enjoy singing the song, then you're going to sign up over here, you're going to pay your union dues, and you're going to get out there and, you know, help the strikers or, you know, whatever other things they might want you to be doing. Now in 1939, right, the Depression's brought us down. One thing that helps pull us out of the Depression is World War II. Now, as we know, World War II, 16 million, primarily men, U.S. men, go off to war in two theaters, Europe and Asia. And so, while those people are gone, the primary way people are getting information at this time is through the radio. Radio is expensive. I mean, if we think about how cheap our media is today, we really take for granted, right? So notice these two images. We've got people gathered around their radios, big things. They're a piece of furniture. Most people could only afford one radio. So what's happening here is generations are listening to the same programming, the same types of music, the same radio broadcasts. So what's happening here is that the family unit is really organized and tight and coherent at this point in society, okay? Because they're all gathered around consuming the same things, okay? And that's important, we'll see, about 20 years later, because eventually the war ends. And when the war ends, you've got 16 million men or so coming back to the United States, and it's Valentine's Day. So, right, you know what they did. They came home to their loved ones, or like this was just a stranger on the street that this guy just found and kissed. So after World War II, we have the baby boom, right? So all of a sudden, you see, right, here we go, the end of the war, and then look what happens up through the late 50s. All of a sudden, there's a great number of kids being born. If you're born in the 50s, you're a teenager in the 60s, okay? And so all of a sudden, this kind of social dynamics begin to change in the U.S. These people need places to live, these new families. There's movements to the suburbs, and one thing I like about aerial photos of suburbs is the similarity, okay? And in fact, as we see with the beginnings of what we might want to call kind of rock and roll or pop music at the time, look at these images. You've got Andy Griffith, Father Knows Best, Leave It to Beaver, Happy Days, very monochromatic, very safe, white bread. Look at the music. You've got somebody like Pat Boone or Paul Anka. This is not something that's very edgy, okay? So at the time, as music is beginning, as these young people are coming up, this is becoming more popular, this rock and roll really what happens in the 60s is the advent of rock and roll, when blues is infused with R&B and with the electrified sounds that are occurring, we finally have rock and roll. Now, what's different at this point is, as cars are more popular and cheaper, as television comes into existence, which is not until the late 40s when it really becomes popular, and not until the 50s that even a lot of homes have them. At this point now, these teenagers who used to sit around the radio with their parents now have other media outlets. And so rock and roll starts to become a little more edgy, okay, around this time. Now, let's not forget that starting in the 50s, we have first advisors in Vietnam. By 1953, the military budget for Vietnam, for our advisors in Vietnam, was $350 million. And by the early 60s, we really start escalating our involvement in Vietnam. Now, as this is occurring, we have the rise of the folk movement, the neo-folk movement. You've got singers like Phil Oakes at the top there, Tom Paxton, Peter, Paul, and Mary. This music is appealing primarily to an educated class. And what's interesting about folk music, as you saw with the Almanac Singers, you didn't really notice the music as much as the lyrics. With folk music, the emphasis is on the lyrics, telling a story. It's easy to hear, it's easy to understand, it's easy to follow along. All right? Folk music then, by its very nature, is designed to send a message out that's easy to understand. Okay? So a lot of the early protest music, because these people are educated, they're paying attention to the news in a very careful, critical way. So they're seeing this build up in Vietnam. They're seeing what's happened with labor relations, etc. So they're responding to it through the music. Obviously, the big players in the folk movement are Bob Dylan and Joan Baez. Joan Baez really brings little Bobby onto stage and gives him the original credibility. And one thing to note about Bob Dylan, and I'm just going to read you a list of, by 1966, he's done with protest music. I mean, a lot of people think of Bob Dylan as a protest singer. But by 1966, he's finished with it. And what's interesting, I find, is that he really only started recording, although his first recording is with Harry Belafonte, his actual recording. 1962 is his first self-titled album. Then we have Freewheelin' in 63, Times Are Changin', and Another Side in 1964. Bringing It All Back Home in Highway 61 in 1965. So within three years, you've got 5 out of his 6 albums are canonical at that, you know. I mean, these are songs that define the age, so to speak. By Blonde on Blonde, on some level, he's pulling back from what we think of as classic protest music. So let's listen. This is a Phil Oakes tune. So this is kind of the typical folky protest song at the time. And this is Phil Oakes, pretty underappreciated these days, but somebody who really worked hard to be a viable and meaningful protest.
Oh, I marched to the Battle of New Orleans at the end of the early British War. The young land started growing. Young blood started flowing, but I ain't marching anymore. For I'd killed my share of engines in 1,000 different fights. I was there at the little big horn. I heard many men lying, I saw many more dying, but I ain't marching anymore. It's always the old to lead us to the wars. It's always young to took it all. We've won with the saber and the gun. Tell me, is it worth it all? For I stole California from the Mexican land, fought in the bloody Civil War. Yes, I even killed my brother. So many others. In the Japanese sky, set off the mighty mushroom roar. When I saw the cities burning, I knew that I was learning, and I ain't marching anymore. Now the labor leaders screaming when they close a missile plant. United Fruit screams at the Cuban shore. Call it peace or call it treason. Call it love or call it reason, but I ain't marching anymore. No, I ain't marching anymore.
Right, so that's kind of your typical idea of the folky protest song. Now, of course, like I said, you've got teenagers now coming into their own, especially as their own subculture. Well, with the advent of TVs in everybody's home, everybody knows that the Beatles, when they hit, really kind of shook things up, because a lot of people then were turned on to rock and roll in a way they hadn't been before. Now, granted, the Beatles were very safe for a long time. In fact, I'd say they were safe until they met Bob Dylan at the Delmonico Hotel in New York, because that was the first time that the Beatles ever experimented with anything that might have loosened their mind up, so to speak. So you can blame Bob Dylan for the way the Beatles suddenly changed their course, but I think became a more relevant institution at that point. So another thing that happens is very important. As the Vietnam War is raging, a draft is instituted. Okay, so this means all men, right? If you're of a certain age, you're going, primarily, right? The lottery, but you're going to go. Unless, of course, you were where? Right, sitting here. So now you've got a lot of people going to college, all right? All of a sudden, college is really popular. So now you've got all these people who don't want to go to Vietnam, okay? They're well-educated. So getting people together where they can talk, exchange ideas, and it's at this point that these mass movements against Vietnam really start occurring. Now, obviously, the folk movement has all their protest songs, but I'd like to play for you now is what I think is one of the best electrified protest songs of the 60s from 1969.
Thank you.
So with this, now Hendrix did the national anthem a lot, but this is probably his most radical version of it. Now think about what protest songs do, right? They promote solidarity within the group, and they try to bring people into what's happening. Now imagine, most of those people attending Woodstock knew people in Vietnam, family members, friends in Vietnam. And here comes Jimi Hendrix on the last day. This is Monday morning, which is why the light is so nice. There's probably only a third of the crowd left from the peak of Woodstock there. And so here he is taking the national anthem, something that's normally seen as a very patriotic thing, and does an act of, if I'm saying this right in the French, détournement, which is you take something that is well known, but then you change it to subvert it. So there are certain things you want your audience to be understanding about the original, but then you're taking that work and then you're changing it to meet your own needs. Francis Bacon did this, the artist, when he had the pictures of the popes that he would do and then smear their faces and stuff like that. So here's Hendrix in 1969 really making a statement in front of all these people, Woodstock Nation, to them, for them, but also to the powers that be, because don't worry, this caused a controversy, obviously, you can imagine, at the time. So, obviously we're coming out now at the end of the decade. In 69 also is kind of the real end of the whole possibility of the flower power movement, because the Rolling Stones have that debacle of a show at Altamont, with the Hells Angels in charge, and that's really seen as kind of the end of the movement and the possibilities of the movement. So now as we move into the 70s, right, we have the rise of arena rock, prog rock, where a lot of the music is about fantasy and escapism and kind of moving away from the harsh reality that a lot of musicians in the 60s were talking about. And so this kind of then hinders, I think, the ability for protest music to be effective. Responding to that is punk, which is not only a political indictment in terms of government, right, but it's also an indictment against the music industry. I mean, right, the Sex Pistols do the song EMI. And it's also the whole kind of DIY aesthetic. You don't have to be like Yes, you know, and be able to do this with the guitar. You can just get up there and bang it out. On one level, it's a return to folk music. Folk music. You and I sit around a campfire, we trade a guitar and play the songs we know. It's not necessarily about the musicianship. It's about the song. It's about the camaraderie. It's about forming a collective, right? Punk music does that in the 70s and 80s for us. Now, as we move into the 90s, the 2000s, once again, we're having similar issues with even the ability to formulate protest music on a mass scale. What I want to show you now is a video from Pearl Jam, from a concert in Uniondale, New York, 2003. And they're doing the tune Bushleaguer, okay? So look at this, right, Pearl Jam, right, at this point, they're real popular. I mean, this is a big band, they're in a big arena. And so let's look at the
uncanny and immutable. This is such a happening tailpipe of a party. Like sugar, the guests are so refined.
Enjoy.
confidence man, but why so beleaguered? He's not a leader, he's a Texas leaguer. We're swinging for the fence, got lucky with a strike. They're drilling for fear, it keeps the job simple. Born on third, thinks he got a triple. Blackout weaves his way through the city. Blackout weaves his way through the city. Blackout weaves his way. I remember when you sang that song about today. Now it's tomorrow and everything has changed. A loof multiplication, a nicotine wish, and a Columbus decanter. Retrenchment and hoggishness. The aristocrat choir sings, what's the ruckus? The haves have not a fucking clue. The immenseness of suffering and the odd negotiation of rarity with onion skin plausibility of life in a keyboard reaffirmation.
Jesus way, the city.
A black owl leaves its way through the city.
The black owl leaves its way.
I remember when you sang that song about today. Now it's tomorrow and everything has changed. I remember when you sang that song about today. Now it's tomorrow and everything has. It's all changed.
Changed, changed, changed.
Busted out the nice suit for you, yeah? Oh, yeah. You didn't like that one.
This is where it gets interesting.
I don't understand. Maybe you like him because he's going to give you a tax cut. Maybe you like him because he's a real guy that relates to you because he's so down home. I'm with you, USA. I just think that all of us in this room should have a voice in how the USA is represented. And he didn't allow us our voice. That's all I'm saying. We love America. I'm standing up on a stage in front of a big crowd. I worked at a goddamn drugstore. I love America, right? This is good. This is open, honest debate, and that's what it should be. If we keep this back and forth, good things will happen. If you don't say anything, you don't know what'll happen.
Now let me show you the next song they played in response. Now this wasn't necessarily out of character for their set list at the time. But I think we'll watch just a minute or so of this, and you should know the song.
This is a public service announcement. Which guitar? Know your rights. Number one, you have the right not to kill.
Now, before we run out of time here, I just wanted to make a note. Like, for instance, the Rolling Stones did the song Street Fightin' Man based on what they're looking at in 1968 out of the Paris student riots, okay? And if you see here, let's see if I can make that, bigger. Yeah, look. Why does it have residence today? This is an interview with Mick Jagger and Rolling Stone. He says, you know, I don't think it has any residence today. It's over with. It doesn't matter anymore, essentially, this song. But what's interesting is that recently some, in London, I don't know if you're aware, students have been rioting in London because of education cuts and increases in tuition. So, you know, in Europe, when students are affected by things, they take to the streets here. I mean, I don't think we do that too often. I mean, we're dealing with that here. Sunday's, yesterday's paper, Bobby Jindal cutting more for education here in Louisiana, and it doesn't seem to matter too much to most people in the grand scheme of things. But really quickly, I want to just talk about Pink Floyd. Pink Floyd you think of as mostly as apolitical, dealing primarily with psychosocial, psychopersonal issues. And the Pink Floyd's The Wall, probably their biggest thing, right? Pink, alienation, not only with himself, but with the audience, the crowd, society, etc. Roger Waters has worked hard. He's been touring The Wall. He's going to be touring it the rest of this year. And one of the things he's really worked towards doing is reconfiguring the message of The Wall. Instead of it being just about an individual, he wants to see The Wall broadened to have a bigger political message. And instead of show, I was going to show you two videos here, but I don't want to run out of time. But one of them is Mother. Have any of you heard that album, The Wall? A few of you? I hope all of you, Jesus, even if you don't like it, I hope you know it, right? Well, Mother, right, the whole idea behind that song is the Pink talking to Mom and about his fears and how Mother's going to comfort him. And he's recast that song so that Mother is no longer the mother like Mom, you know, your mom that you look up to, Mom, but instead it's more of a governmental figure who will watch out over you. And if you go on YouTube, you can find this clip where you see during the song he's got a giant camera like they have in Britain. You know, Britain's full of these security cameras now that are always watching everything. And so Mother now takes the role of Big Brother. And in fact, it says Big Brother is watching you, but it's scratched out to say Big Mother is watching you. And he even got into trouble because Goodbye Blue Sky, he's showing bombers going with dropping crosses on people instead of bombs, dropping dollar signs, dropping Muslim crescents, Star of David's, Shell Oil symbols, right? And so he's really trying to make a political statement with this piece. And it's been very effective. There's some great videos on YouTube that show this. So let me just show, this is like 40 seconds of Roger Waters talking a little bit here.
My personal fight against my own immurement, my own hiding behind a wall because I was a frightened young man, could be seen as an allegory or as a microscopic example of something that is capable of much larger interpretation. Nations and religions and groupings of people of one sort or another wall themselves in behind their ideologies because they're frightened of the other. I've written all this on the fucking website. Groups of people get frightened and they then build walls, and it then makes it harder and harder for them to establish lines of communication with the ones that they consider to be other, the foreigners, the evil ones, you know, the towelheads, the Muslims or the Christians or whoever it might be. In consequence, we flounder around in a situation that one would have hoped would have died out at the end of the 16th century with the Fourth Crusade. It's an expression of my belief that we are all capable of change, and we're all capable of change for the better, and that if we are fearful, and in consequence of that fear we separate ourselves from others and point fingers at them and want to fight with them, we are all individually and as groups capable of moving away from that position into a position where we say, maybe it would be better to try and understand other people. Unfortunately, we have failed to transcend our bigotry and dogma and attachment to fundamental ideologies, and in consequence we're still blowing each other up at an alarming rate. I feel that if with my work I can adopt and express the position that that's a very bad thing, I will do so now and tomorrow, and I shall continue to do so for as long as I continue to work.
Right, so instead of the wall being that wall that we create as individuals because of what's happened to us and the kind of things we've experienced, and so we don't want to let other people in, what he's making the point now is that these ideologies that we are exposed to, that form us, that create us as individuals, that are oftentimes we're unaware of, that these are actually creating the walls, like in Berlin, like in Palestine right now. I've been working a little bit with Daniela Marks, graphic arts professor here at Loyola, and we've been talking about the intersection of politics and art. And she's been doing some pieces based around these ideas. And one of the things issues that she's been dealing with is cuts in education here in Louisiana. And so we had toyed around with the idea of taking another Brick in the Wall Part 2, which we all know the chorus, right? Do we know it? We don't need no education, right? So what? There you go. Yeah, we could do the whole thing right here, right? Well, she wants to take that piece and create something with it, an art piece that will respond to what's been happening with cuts, your tax dollars being cut away from something that is fundamentally important, right? We spend probably per student per day around $5, but for a prisoner in Angola, we spend about 5 times that per day. What if we flipped that, right? Maybe people wouldn't end up in prison. Well, it's a novel concept. But I want to introduce Daniela Marks now. She's going to talk about it. And you know what? We've talked about protest stuff. Now maybe some of you would want to participate in it. So I hope you do. Thanks. You want this?